So this is one of my favorite topics. It's obviously a really big topic. And I remember one of the jokes one of the consultants used to ask me during Viva training was, where's the most dangerous place to anaesthetize someone? Of course, it's the Viva, because everyone seems to arrest or have some kind of catastrophe. So crisis management, what I really love about this is, so this took me a while to really come up with, but I found that this three-phase kind of approach really, really helped me to talk through any part of the Viva. So the crisis can be a real massive spectrum of presentations and questions of the Viva. And so take from this talk what you will. These three phases can be interchanged any different part of the exam that you might get. So crisis management framework, a crisis occurs or some kind of problem occurs. Phase one is really just safety and optimization to kind of get you into the realm of talking safely about something. Phase two is about the cause, and phase three is treatment. Often a lot of these will happen simultaneously, but it doesn't mean that you can't have a structured approach to this as well. So there's a lot of problems with crises in the Viva, and I think we've all, if we've done Vivas in the past, we've all seen how this happens. Like, you don't have all the visual cues. It's easy to forget some small details whilst you're trying to say and describe and consider and manage everything. So, you know, it can be really tricky, and examiners may pick on something that you think is pretty minor and that you would have obviously done. So it's really hard to mind read what the examiner's thinking, plus show everything that you do in a complex situation when in real life you'd be in that situation managing it. But the good thing is that it isn't real. The skills you have are what you say you have. So you may be completely terrible at putting art lines or central lines or managing a crisis, but it doesn't matter because you can fake it in this exam. So what I think is the right method and approach can solve any problem. And you know, one of those things, if you can fake the language that I'll hopefully give you here, it will really help you to, you know, actually practice this in real life as well. That said, you may have your own method, so please, you know, this is my approach. It's completely non-evidence-based, but just really helps me to talk through the complexity of what happens in the Viva, but also real life. So please, take it for what it is. It's just opinion. Now, just to start off with some tips. So examiners, when I came up with this course over the years, I talked to examiners a lot about what they want and what they're really examining on. And one of the examiners who I asked about crises in particular said the examiners want to test you on small changes. So just to know that not everything is a crisis. A small change in blood pressure isn't a crisis. It isn't particularly stressful. It happens every day in almost, you know, every patient. They get a lot more out of small change than what you do with small deviations from normality than a complete arrest. Think about what that means. This whole time I've been talking about what is normal and what is not a point of difference or not discriminative between candidates. If you arrest every single patient, that's just ALS guidelines and that's very easy to follow. But if you make subtle changes with a certain amount of nuance and a lack of an arrest, then it differentiates between people's decision making far better than something that's a guideline. If something is a crisis, it is important to say so. But also, if it isn't a crisis, you can vary your phrasing to reflect the urgency. So, you know, just again, get comfortable using different words to make things not a cliche. This is an emergency. This is a crisis. This is concerning. This is troubling. I'm genuinely worried about this. Again, try to vary your phrasing as it happens to you in real life in this Viva. So the first phase, let's talk about this case. 60-year-old male, nil past history, meds or allergies. 10 minutes into the carotid endarterectomy, the patient becomes hypertensive at 200 millimeters mercury.
I recognize this is concerning blood pressure in this situation. My immediate management is to confirm the reading and communicate to the surgeons. I confirm the reading by looking at the transducer and flushing the arterial line. I temporize the situation by pulsing, checking the airway, confirming my monitors, entire CO2, etc., and pulsing a propofol remifentanil, which is what I'd like to be using for my...
Yeah, fantastic. So again, you said a lot of really important things there, and I just want to highlight this. This is definitely a bit of a statement that I say, so take from it what you will that's relevant to each situation. A few things are probably often always relevant. So I've just said, with a finger on the pulse, if something's really dire, like, you know, peri-arrest, I'd probably want to have a finger on the pulse just to make sure that I can always be identifying an arrest and then proceed with ALS if that's relevant. That's often not going to be something you do. So just take that with a grain of salt. I always want to say something along the lines of, I'm scanning the patient, the surgery, and all monitors, all my environment. I'm scanning that because that's what you would do in real life. And I've had that instance where someone says, oh, well, you know, you didn't say that you looked at the CO2. And so I think it's really great to be able to just go, I'm broadly looking and doing a general inspection of the environment. Again, I really like, Anna, that you said confirm the reading. Like, you know, a lot of our ability to detect problems is to, you know, read our monitors. And our monitors are simply monitors, and they're as good as the accuracy of their reading. So if your transducer is falling in this situation, or if your pulse oximeter is shaking, or your entitled is lost because of a blockage, you really aren't treating the right thing. So you absolutely need to confirm that reading, and that's what I was getting at with this particular situation. I then, you know, at different levels of, you know, if you're a really junior person, you'd call for help straight away. But as you get more senior, you probably, one of the things that will come up is you may feel like you need to call for help when the blood pressure goes to 80 on a normal induction. So, you know, just to reflect on that and realize that, you know, chances are you probably won't call for help until something is actually really dire in your, you know, in your senior practice now, and to just appreciate that realism. I like the fact that you said temporize. I think that's always the next step. You scanned everything, you've confirmed the reading, you've sent for help if relevant, and most of us will temporize measures, or optimize, I've called it here, but temporize with a bit of fluid and aramine, or a bit of propofol and remi, or paralysis and bag ventilation and increasing the oxygen. So we do some very familiar steps that are very real, and I would always talk through this because that's exactly what I do in real life, and that's what the examiner is asking me. I then assess the patient and treat. So phase one is simply just getting quickly through these, and I wouldn't take much more than a few seconds to get through this because, again, they're not necessarily points that differentiate you from other candidates, but I think they're absolutely necessary because that's what I do in real life. So I can't fake this by not mentioning it. So phase two is the cause. Again, this can occur in isolation and often occurs simultaneously. I'm talking about causes as I'm differentiating things, as well as managing each cause that I go through. But just to break it up and just to give you a bit of a suggestion on how to really tackle causes and how to talk through them really efficiently to get to the point that the examiners want to get to, I've just got this approach. Anyway, so let's go through this. A 60-year-old male, heavy smoker with COPD from emergency laparotomy, desaturates during the case. What do you think is causing this?
I think that this could be a multifactorial cause. Mm-hmm. However, moving methodically, there's potential for reversible bronchospasm, mm-hmm. So a bronchospastic component. Mm-hmm. They could have atelectasis and basal collapse during the laparotomy. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, there could be increased plugging and mucus formation in the presence of being a heavy smoker.
Yeah, that's good. And you gave me a really real, a real answer, right? So the stuff that you mentioned is literally what would happen time and time again, day in, day out, for a COPD patient having hypoxemia. So what I'd say is that you've done, you know, in the first part, we talk about systematic categorized answers, but these are slow. And I think in real life, so, you know, this is an exam of real life. In real life, experts use probability gambits, but we can combine that with a systematic exclusion of differentials. And this would be borne out in a lot of the crisis management literature out there. So I would say something pretty similar to you. I would preface it with these phrases. Look, I think this is most likely X. So the serious differentials I must rule out are these. And you're likely to show a lot of clinical acumen by doing those first two statements. But if you're wrong, if the examiner isn't satisfied by that, you can always go through your systematic review or differential if you're prompted to. So in that example, I could have gone, yep, great. It's probably bronchospasm. You auscultate the lungs. Let's go, let's manage it. Or maybe I'm unsatisfied with what you've said and I'll just be like, and what else and what else? Then you can take a step back and you can go, okay, so you're not happy with this is most likely. You're not happy that I've looked at all the really serious stuff that obviously I need to rule out urgently. Great, hypoxemia can be FI, hyperventilation, shunt, VQ mismatch, or diffusion abnormality. The detail of these that I'll rule out systematically is blah, 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 blah. So I'm trying to get you to have your cake and eat it in a sense that you can get to the answer quickly, but again, like everything else, we get to the point of difference, but we also are able to give the full gamut of a completely systematic and thorough answer if required. But I suspect that most of the time this Viva, you'll get through with that point of difference, that critical, you know, the critical issue or the most likely diagnoses. Someone in the chat just asked about the phrase simultaneously diagnose and treat. And everything I know about examiners you that is definitely a true statement that you do that. But I'd say that you could now, because that's a thing that's said so often, it's a thing that's known, it's a thing that everyone understands that we do. I'd say that that's probably just a waste of words, is my personal opinion. Because if you were to say, I would simultaneously diagnose and treat, you could save the time by saying, for this hypoxemia, I'm going to rule out bronchospasm. I check the circuit, auscultate the lungs, if there's any bronchospasm, treat with it, Ventolin, Atrovent. And you can just, you know, you can literally do the simultaneous diagnosing and treating without actually needing to say the words simultaneously diagnose and treat. So my opinion, probably don't need to say it, probably a waste of breath. If you're really smooth with this kind of crisis management talk, you'll end up doing exactly what you said you were going to do without using those extra words. Quick summary, crisis occurs. Your phase one is safety and optimization or temporization steps. So you check your reading, doctor's ABCs. Your phase two is phrase literally, it is most likely this, the serious differentials I must rule out are these. And if the examiner is unhappy or unsatisfied with those differentials, then I can go through my whole list of stuff. And you'll note in your workbooks, I've just got my tables that I've listed of all the different common problems that I'd see. And I think the biggest part of that was to just write out my own table. So, you know, obviously you can use those tables. I found it really useful to have those. But I reckon, you know, everyone's got a slightly different way of thinking about these problems. And so I think one of the biggest things I did for this exam was to actually draw the tables up myself. So I've processed the table, I've made decisions about how I categorize things and how I diagnose and approach things. So I'd say use the tables, but draw up your own tables as well. And make it your own. Phase three, which we'll go through, is treatment. For the next exercise, let's go through some diagnostics. So this occurs, a 24-year-old for appendectomy. The blood pressure is, say, maybe 80 is a bit higher than, a bit too normal. Let's go with the blood pressure is 70 post-induction, and you did a very standard induction with 200 of propofol, 100 of sux for this otherwise fit person, and say 100 or 200 of fentanyl. Blood pressure is 70 post-induction. You would do all the normal things which we won't need to go through, but definitely in your practice those. So, you know, finger on the pulse, I'd just scan my monitors, my surgeon, the patient, check my reading, maybe recycle the blood pressure and give some fluid and aramine as temporization steps. And then I think this is, you know, and go through your diagnosis.
This is hypertension, most likely post-induction. Mm-hmm. This differentials, I must rule out anaphylaxis, septic shock.
Yeah, sounds good. And that's good. If it's directly post-induction, I completely agree with you. It's most likely due to the anesthetic agents. And imagine yourself in the Viva. You don't want to get into that pattern of overcalling everything. You know, just be very comfortable in thinking that this is probably normal. I would temporize things and then I would look for other bad things. And that's probably what you do in real life on the second cycle of that blood pressure. And depending on what part of the surgery it is, it's anything from anaphylaxis, sepsis to lap port injury. Those are the really bad things I want to look at. And if I'm wrong about those, if the examiner is unsatisfied, I've got all my causes of hypertension. Take whatever classification you want, preload, rate, rhythm, contractility, afterload, or distributive, obstructive, cardiogenic, hypovolemic shock classifications, whatever you want, at least you've got your backup if you're wrong about those two. Let's try the next one. 40-year-old patient for a lap collie becomes tachycardic on incision.
So my first thought will be this is a reaction to the pain, and I will give the anesthesia. And if the patient doesn't respond, consider other possible diagnosis like anaphylaxis or electrolyte disturbance, hypovolemia.
Okay, good. So again, I think most of us would agree this is either pain or light anesthesia, pretty common, but I really care about ruling out things like anaphylaxis or, you know, have they gone into some kind of SVT or VT, depending on how fast the heart rate is. Again, in that situation, you have a lot of indicators, but being able to go straight to what's really bad about the situation is vital. Good, next one, 25-year-old asthmatic patient.